Welcome to the discussion video on Module 3 or Chapter 3 of the Government Accounting Process. At the end of this module, we will be able to record the basic transactions of government entity and to prepare a worksheet for government accounting reporting. So let us first read a backgrounder. The government accounting process comprises the activities of analyzing, recording, classifying, summarizing, and communicating transactions involving the receipt and disposition of government funds and property, and interpreting the results thereof. This process is similar to that of a business entity, except that it incorporates budgetary controls such as recording in the budget registries and preparing periodic budget accountability reports. So kung if you observe, most of the discussions and the questioning in government accounting look into the comparison and the contrast between accounting for government and accounting for a normal business entity o yung mga private entities. So they are essentially the same. Governing the accounting, basic accounting principles, they are essentially the same, involving the receipt of funds and the disposition of these funds through incurrence of expenditures. Ang pinagkaiba lang under the government accounting is that it is budgetary accounting o merong tinatawag na mga budget registries ang government accounting in the Philippines. So these budgetary reporting, budgetary controls ay kinakailangan so that makita natin yung accountability doon sa budget. Kasi di ba on the planning stages we provide for our goals and the programs and activities of that government agency. So merong nakaset na budget for that. So ngayon kapag ikaw ay nag-incur naman ng disposition or disbursement ng funds na yan, kailangan i-monitor din natin kung yan ba ay naka-align doon sa budget na pina-approve natin during the planning stages. So let us look at the books of accounts and registries. So meron gumagamit din tayo dito ng journals, ledgers, and yung registries ang pinagkaiba. Under the journals, we look at general journal, cash receipts journal, cash disbursements journal, and the check disbursements journal. The ledgers, we have general ledgers and the subsidiary ledgers. So lahat in government accounting, wala na po tayong minemaintain na manual records nito. Ideally, dapat wala na kasi gumagamit tayo ng National Government Accounting System, the Electronic National Government Accounting System, o yung ENGAS in government. Lahat po ng generations ng pag-record natin ng journal entries sa ating mga general journal, cash receipts, disbursements, ay doon na mismo makikita sa ating online, kumbaga online journals na ito. Na-generate na rin natin doon yung ledgers at yung mga general and subsidiary ledgers. So let's look and focus on the registries kasi ito ay dito mo lang siya may encounter on government accounting. One is the registries of revenue and other receipts, registry of appropriations and allotments, registries of allotments, obligations and disbursements, registries of budget utilization and disbursements. So iisa-isahin po natin lahat yan. Okay? So technically, only the journals and ledgers are considered accounting records. These are similar to the accounting records of a business entity, yung private entities. The registries are just budget records. These are used to monitor the budget. You may think of the registries like log books or something rather than accounting books with debit and credit columns. The accounting unit of the agency maintains the journals and ledgers while the budget division of the agency maintains the registries. So at the point of view of the accountant, ang kanyang accounting records ay yung journals at ledgers pa rin. Nagme-maintain tayo ng registry for monitoring purposes or as logbooks doon sa ating mga budgets and appropriations. Kaya nga yung mga registries ay minemaintain yan ng budget division at yung mga journals and ledgers ay minemaintain ng accounting division. Recall that the separate accounting records and budget registries are maintained for each fund cluster. So regular agency, foreign assisted, and so on. Diba, nag-discuss tayo nung fund clusters bawat isang journal, bawat isang ledger ay nakasegregate pa yon kung ilang fund cluster. For example, regular agency fund, may sarili-sarili yung general journal, cash receipts, cash disbursements, check disbursements journal, general ledger, and subsidiary ledger. Kapag napunta ka naman sa revolving fund or trust receipts, may kanya-kanya din yung journals and ledgers. So let us differentiate yung registries. The registries of revenue and other receipts are used to monitor the budgeted amounts, actual collections, and remittances of revenue and other receipts. So, madali lang naman maintindihan itong registries. May sample din tayo ng registries in the succeeding discussion. As the name of the registry is termed, RROR, these are revenue and other receipts. So, lahat ng collections related to revenue. Okay, lahat ng income yan kapag Registry of Revenue and Other Receipts. Kapag Registry of Appropriations and Allotments, this is used to monitor appropriations and allotments. This is to ensure that allotments will not exceed appropriations. So, madali naman siyang maintindihan. Kung yung appropriation mo is 5 million, dapat the allotment mo ay hindi lalagpas doon. Kumbaga, tinitingnan natin yan. Binabangga yung appropriation with the amount of allotment na nirelease. Diba? Yung appropriation, ito yung nandun sa, for example, nasa General Appropriations Act mo ay 5 million. Ang allotment na nirelease sa'yo ng DBM ay 1 million lang for first quarter, for example. Para lang makita natin na hindi susobra yung nare-release sa atin na allotment. Kasi dapat the appropriation should be less than the appropriation should be equal lang dun sa total allotments na nirelease sa atin. So at times hindi pwedeng mas mataas yung allotment kaysa sa appropriation mo. Registry of allotments, obligations and disbursements. Dito naman may details ka na ng allotment, so itinitingnan lang yung magkano na yung doon sa allotment na binigay sa iyo ng DBM, magkano na doon yung na obligate o yung mga obligations, 'di ba? Kapag obligations, these are ito yung nagba-bind doon sa mga officers ng agency na eventually ay babayaran yung mga inutang na mga transaction. Then, yung disbursements naman, yun, ito na yung eventual payment. Yung lahat ng inobligate ay babayaran na. So, kailangan lang nating i-monitor yan in a registry para at the end of the year, makita natin na magkano pa doon sa allotment ang hindi pa na-obligate at magkano pa doon sa obligated ang hindi pa na-disburse or hindi pa natin nababayaran. Okay. Separate raod shall be maintained for each object of expenditure. So, okay. Ano tong raod na sinasabi? Ito po yung allotments, obligations, and disbursements. So, bakit kailangan merong separate raod for each object of expenditure? Ano ba itong object of expenditure? So, dito muna po may encounter yung four major classification of expenditures in government accounting. Kailangan alam mo ito. 1. Personal services, next MOOE, the maintenance and other operating expenses, then the financial expenses, and then the capital outlay. So in government accounting, kapag nagre-release po ng budget ay laging ang tenor ng usapan ay ano ba to, budget for PS, budget for capital outlay ba to, or budget for MOOE. Kasi dito rin lumalabas yung issues related to technical malversation o yung corruption. Bakit? Because 'di ba ang sinasabi kung saang line item inappropriate yung budget, dapat doon lang siya gagamitin. So these are major classifications of those types of expenditures. Kapag sinabi nating personal services, ito yung lahat ng sweldo, benefits, salaries, bonuses, allowances, cash gifts ng lahat ng permanent employees in the government. Please take note of that. lahat ng permanent employees in the government, ibig sabihin yung mayroong mga plantilla positions. While the maintenance and other operating expenses, these pertain to the various operating expenses other than employee benefits and financial expenses. So, karamihan ng classifications ng expenditures in government ay naka-under sa MOOE kasi ito yung catch-all. Halimbawa, travel, utilities, supplies, and other expenses. Kapag financial expenses, these are related to finance costs, mga interest expense, bank charges, and other financial expenses, which also includes losses on foreign exchange transactions. Basta all related to financial costs, yung financing costs, yung mga related. So, interest, bank charges, mga ganyan, financial expenses yan. So, dito sa apat, ito yung mas konti yung amounts na naka-budget. Kasi maliit na mga amounts lang naman yung interest, bank charges, as compared doon sa pasweldo, operating expenses, and among others. Okay, next, capital outlays. These pertain to capitalizable expenditures, expenditures on the construction of public infrastructures, acquisition cost of equipment, etc. Itong MOOE at capital outlay, these are, ito yung malalaking amounts. Itong maintenance and other operating expenses ay madalas it kasing meron tayong ganito. Yung capital outlay, paminsan-minsan lang ito, pero at malalaking amount. For example, yung build program, yung paggawa ng mga bridges, pagbili ng malalaking equipment, heavy equipment truck, yan po ay naka-charge under the capital outlay. So, yung mga property, plant, and equipment, dito po yan naka-under sa capital outlay. Ito ang major classification ng expenditure na yun. So, accordingly, the following separate RAOD shall be maintained. So, meron po tayong RAOD for PS, RAOD for MOOE, RAOD FE, and RAOD CO. Okay? Next, we proceed with the Registries of Budget, Utilization, and Disbursements, or the RBUD. So, dito, di ba meron ka ng budget? Titingnan lang po yung utilization and disbursements mo. So, paano yun nakocompute? Okay, this is used to record the approved special budget and the corresponding utilizations and disbursements charged to retained income. Separate RBUDs are also maintained for each object of expenditures. So, meron po tayong binibigay sa atin, for example, a special budget for this item. Tinitingnan lang yung utilization. Ibig sabihin ng utilization kung magkano na yung nagastos doon sa budget na yon at kung magkano na yung na-disburse. Okay? Later, we will have a concrete sample for that. Okay, let's try this example. Keeping the general accounts. The COA shall keep the general accounts of the government and preserve the vouchers and other supporting documents. So lahat po yan at the end of the month ay sinasubmit sa COA for their safekeeping, for their preservation, and for their audit. So, let us take a look at the basic recording. So, paano natin nire-record yung appropriation? So, if entity A, a government agency, receives its General Appropriations Act consisting of the following. So, na-approve po yung GAA at galing sa, at ito yung appropriation na ibinigay sa kanya. 100,000 for PS, MOE 60, financial expenses 0, capital outlays 200,000. So the total appropriation for the year is 360. The receipt of the appropriation is posted or recorded in the Registry of Appropriations and Allotments, yung RAPAL, as follows. So paano mo siya ipopost? Okay, ito yung sample niya. Entity name, fund cluster, halimbawa regular agency fund. So meron po tayong date dyan. Reference is the GAA. Date kung kailan po na-receive yan. Okay, the appropriation. So, i-detalye mo lang dito kung magkano yung PS, MOE, FECO, then the total. So, andito po yun sa column ng appropriations. So, dahil wala ka pang allotment, wala pang nakalagay dyan. At dito ay yung unreleased appropriation, wala pa rin. Okay? Next, allotment. The entity receives its allotment from the DBM. So, si DBM nagbigay na ng authorization doon sa government agency na mag-incur na sila ng obligation. Remember, the appropriation is an authorization made by law. Na? Appropriation is an authorization made by law para dito sa amounts na ito. While allotment is an authorization made by the DBM doon sa agency para pwede na siyang mag-incur ng obligations or pwede na siyang mangutang para doon sa transactions niya. Not necessarily mangutang, pero mas madali kasi siyang maintindihan when I say mangutang dahil nakikipag-transact ka sa outside suppliers nang wala pang bayad. Kumbaga, ang guarantee ng mga outside suppliers na yun na babayaran sila is the obligation, yung obligation document. Okay? So, meron daw allotment amounting to 300,000 for these items, PS 90, MOE 40, and capital outlay 170. So, lagi mo pong titingnan that the allotment is always less than the appropriation. At, yan po, makikita mo siyang ganyan. 90, 40, and 170. Okay, let's proceed. The receipt of the allotment is now posted in the RAPAL and the RAOD. Kasi meron tayong registry of may kasamang allotment dyan. Sa RAOD, meron ding allotment as the first column. So, i-indicate mo lang po dito kung kailan date, reference, allotment. Okay. The unreleased appropriation, ima-minus mo lang po yung nandun sa appropriation minus the allotment. Okay? The registry of allotments and obligations, so i-plot mo lang po dun sa column ng allotments. Yan. Okay? Registry of allotments, obligations. So dito allotments pa lang. So wala pa namang obligation. Okay, let's proceed with the incurrence of obligation. Yung document natin dito is the obligation request and status or the ORS. The obligation shall be incurred through the issuance of the ORS. The requesting office shall prepare this document supported by valid claim documents like disbursement vouchers, payroll, purchase job orders, itinerary of travel, etc. The head of the requesting office shall certify the necessity and legality of the obligation and the validity of the supporting documents. The head of the budget division shall certify the availability of the allotment. So, entity A enters into the following contracts. PS, employment contracts, job order amounting to 70,000. Maintenance and other operating services, purchase contract for office supplies worth 25. Capital outlays, purchase contract for office equipment worth 160. So, the OR is prepared as follows. So, tingnan natin yung kanyang ORS. So, ito po yung sample ng ORS. May pirma yung head or ng requesting office kung saan nanggaling yung ORS at yung supporting document. And pinipirmahan din siya ng budget division to certify that the requested amounts are available based on the allotments. So, naka-indicate lang po dyan yung responsibility center, particulars, the UWACS code. The UWACS code, nandun ito po sa GAM. So, makikita natin doon yung UWACS code, yung unified coding structure po yan. Okay, so may payee dyan, the office address. So, yung payee, yan po yung babayaran natin eventually pag nag-issue ka ng disbursement voucher. The statement of obligations, naka-itemize po dito kung saan kukunin yung item. Okay. To simplify the illustration, only one OR is presented for the three contracts. Separate OR should be prepared for each of them. Okay, pinagsama niya kasi dito sa isang ORS yung lahat ng items, pero in practice hindi pwede yung ganon. Halimbawa, itong ORS for the 70,000, iba yung dapat yung ORS for MOE and iba yung ORS for the capital outlay. Kasi separate transactions yan, hindi naman yan related transactions. Registry of allotments, obligations, and disbursements. Okay. And other operating expenses. Sometimes there are adjustments can be made. So we provide for the notice of obligation request and status adjustments. So if the obligations recorded in the RAOD and ORS have above need to be adjusted, the subsequent adjustment shall be made through the NORSA. The adjustment shall be effected through a positive entry addition or a negative entry reduction as appropriate. So yan po yung ginagamit, yung NORSA. This, up to this point, nothing is recorded yet in the accounting books. The recordings above are made on the budget registries. Journal entries shall be made only after there are services rendered, there are delivery and receipt of supplies, and the office equipment is delivered and received. So kung mapapansin mo, the initial movement on the recording will be on the registries at hindi dun sa mismong journals and ledgers. Okay? Only after the events occur, tsaka lang po tayo maggagawa ng record sa ating mga journals and ledgers. So, as of this moment, yung nag-appropriate pa lang at nagbigay pa lang ng allotment, wala pa po tayong, at nag-obligate pa lang, wala pa po tayong recording sa ating accounting records. So, let us just differentiate under the government entity, kapag kasi in government accounting kasi, iba ang gamit ng term na obligation unlike when it is in the business entity. Diba? Kung hindi mo pa napag-aaralan ng government accounting, alam mo na kapag obligation, this means this is another term for liability. Pero in government entity, an obligation is an authorization by the official of that government agencies which binds the government agency contracting to a third party or a supplier for the immediate or eventual payment of a sum of money. So parang ito nga yung sinasabi kong nangungutang ka using the ORS or the obligation request and status as a document na nagbabind sa government na babayaran ka in the future. Obligation may be referred to as a commitment that encompasses possible future liabilities based on current contractual agreement. Okay. I think we have to end at this point, and then itutuloy natin dito sa pag na-receive mo na yung notice of cash allocation. Please continue on the succeeding video for more. Thank you.